Do you need to know how to make off an SWA gland so that you can complete a successful steel wire armoured cable installation? Well, you've come to the right place. Stay tuned, let me show you how. First step is to ensure that you select the correct size of gland for the cable. Knowing your cable size and how many cores it's got, consult this table and you can find out which size of gland to use, and then add BW or CW suffix for either non-waterproof or waterproof. I'm connecting to a waterproof outdoor enclosure, and I'm connecting to a fuse connection unit within that enclosure, so I only need to put my gland 6 inches or so down the cable. If you were using a waterproof box, for example, connecting the cable on the outside on your wall and then taking the inner cores through the wall to the FCU on the inside, or to a fuse board on the inside, then you would need to put your gland much further down the cable so that you've got more inner core available to push through the wall. Support your cable firmly just past where the gland is going to go, making sure that you've left enough length for whatever accessory box you're going into. Now, the eagle-eyed amongst you will have noticed that I have actually got a special tool for this piece of the process. I'll come on to that in a moment. With your junior hacksaw and a fine blade, gently cut through the outer sheath until you can feel the blade engage on the armoured wires, and just score the wires, and then do that all the way around the circumference of the cable. And to make sure that you get the underside as well, put your saw in upside down. Now, there is a tool you can buy for doing this. It's not unlike a pipe cutter that a plumber might use for cutting copper pipe. You engage it on the wire. It's got a little saw blade in there, and you whizzle it round and round and round, and the saw blade scores the armour. This one is called Blade Runner. But to be honest, these are crap. They really are dismal. When I was an electrician, I had two or three of these, and then I gave up on them and went back to the old method. This works every time. It's dead simple and it's dead cheap. If you're a DIYer in particular, don't bother with one of these. You're just wasting your money. Now that you've scored the armour, with a sharp knife, cut along the length of the outer sheath and take the outer sheath off. The armoured wires are wound helically down the cable before the sheath is applied. Take hold of a few cables at the end and unwind them from the inner, and then where you've scored them, bend them back and forth a couple of times and the armoured wires come off. Repeat that until you've got all of them off. And you should have a nice neat end, and do make sure that you've not gone through the armour and nicked the inner sheath. Release whatever system you're using to hold your cable and pull out about another inch, either with a knife or maybe with your saw again. Just cut the outer sheath. You're not trying to score the armour this time, and cut that piece off. We're not looking to remove this piece of armour. Before we do anything else with the cable, we need to separate our gland. If your gland is a waterproof gland, if it's a CW gland, it'll have a big nut on the end with a rubber insert which seals to the outer sheath later once we've got the gland on. There's a middle nut and then the main part of the gland with a ring which traps the armour onto this conical portion of the brass ring. Top tip, you need to be sure you get this the right way around. The inside of the ring there is conical shaped to match the shape on here. So you need to make sure that you're putting it on the right way around. These other pieces, the banjo and the nut, we'll come to in a minute. Next, cut your shroud to suit the outer diameter of your cable and fit it over your cable. You should get a nice snug fit. Follow that with the nut that's got the rubber O-ring system in it and the middle nut, and the wedding ring, as I like to call it. We now need to put the main body of the gland on. Before we do that, take hold of your cable in one hand and your inner sheath in the other. Wind that round and round in the same direction that the armour is coiled, and you'll see it just opens the armour up away from the inner sheath. No need to go mad. Now put the main body of the gland down here so that the conical section fits inside the armour, but don't overlap the armour onto the thread. Bring your wedding ring up to the conical section. Now bring the middle nut up over the wedding ring and the armour, being careful not to pull the armour out, and start winding the middle nut on onto its thread. You'll probably only get two or three turns on, and then you won't be able to go any further by hand. When you get to that point, you'll need a couple of spanners. You can use spanners and pipe grips, adjustable spanners like I am. I like to use one pipe grip or adjustable spanner and one correct spanner. If you use all correct spanners, you'd have to have several sets of spanners so that you've got several spanners of the same size. An adjustable spanner and a correct spanner makes all the difference. And continue to tighten that down until it's tight. And when it's tight, just bring it far enough that you line up the corners of the hexes on the nuts. That's not essential, that's just a tip of mine that makes it easier to put the shroud on later. So now what you've got is you've got a ring in there that's trapping those armoured cables on the cone of the main body, and by tightening this down, that traps those armour wires in there and makes for good both physical and electrical contact. Bring your waterproof nut, the one that's got the rubber O-ring in it. I find that the application of a little water or spittle helps here. Screw this nut in exactly the same way as you did the mid nut, but don't go mad. As you wind this in, you'll find that it constricts onto the outer sheath, and that makes for a waterproof joint. And again, line up your flats and corners. And that's the gland fitted to the cable, but we're nowhere near finished yet. Now we need to connect our gland into our enclosure, whatever that enclosure might be. And that's where the banjo and the nut come in. Push the wires and the gland into your hole in the bottom of your enclosure. Put the banjo over and the nut and tighten it down. Now to the banjo, you would normally connect a piece of earth cable using an eyelet and a nut and screw. That's the traditional method of doing it. But I would thoroughly recommend that you use some of these earth nuts. The way these work is very simple. They have a screw on one flat that you can use to connect your earth lead to, and in another flat they have a grub screw. Usually they come in packets of 10 and they come with an Allen key for taking the grub screw out. Remove both the grub screw and the screw for the earth connection. Put your cable in your enclosure along with your gland and then apply your earth nut. Now the earth nuts, top tip, have a plain face on one side, and on the other side they have little teeth. I would suggest if you're using a metal enclosure, wind it down with the little teeth against the metal. If like me, you're using a plastic enclosure, wind it down with the plain face against the plastic. Try to position this nut so that you can access two of the holes on the flats. On one of those holes, return the little screw and use it to connect an earth lead with an eyelet on the end. And in the other hole, return the grub screw to the hole and then nip it down so that it engages into the thread of the gland. That does two things. It provides a good mechanical connection between the gland and the earth nut, which will prevent the earth nut from coming undone. And at the same time, it also provides a good electrical connection between the gland and the earth nut, and consequently your earth wire. Don't forget to push your sheath up over your gland. A little bonus tip here to help make sure that your installation lasts an awful long time. If your armoured cable is coming into the side or the top of your enclosure, such that water might run down the cable or otherwise get onto the portion where the sheath meets the outer sheath of the cable, apply a few layers of self-amalgamating tape. That will make sure that you have a nice waterproof connection here, so that if any water runs along the cable, it'll run along there and away. Self-amalgamating tape, also known as self-fusing tape, is a wondrous product for many, many uses. I'll do a separate video on how to use this. If you got good value out of this video, please give it a like down by the title. Consider subscribing, and I shall see you next time.